Hello and welcome back to Rolling Solo. My name is Adam Smith and we are currently playing A Ship in a Storm and we are in the 10th round. As of the last video, we moved that marker from 9 to 10. There is one thing I want to do though before I start the 10th round, and that is to short rest. And I want to do it mainly with the Craig Hart this time. I also want to do it with the Tinker as well, even though I don't find it all that necessary. I do want to do it, and the reason being is I really want to get a certain card back with the Tinkerer that allows me to attack two different targets, and I'm hoping when we short rest we don't accidentally have to remove that card, because that would be really sad. So the first one we'll do is do the Craig Hart right away, and we'll do a quick shuffle here. We're going to split this in half, and I'm taking this one. So it looks like Sentinel Growth, the healing and move one. Oh, that's too bad. It's going to go. I'm okay with this though because, well, I'm not okay with it, but I just don't feel like losing a health either, because once we get attacked by these guys, we're going to need every bit of health we can keep our hands on. But at least at this point, it gives me options going into this round in terms of what we can do. Actually, I just realized my Battle Goal card for the Craig Hart is to take only long rests. Come on, take only long rests during the scenario. So, should I just not do that then? If I long rest and I'm just sitting there doing nothing, but this might be the good time to do nothing. Don't know if it's ever really a good time to do nothing. Yeah, you know what? Yikes. Well, I kind of messed this up at the same time because I've already put cards in the tray. So I've already kind of made a mess of things. So let's just go ahead and do the long rest. I'm going to have to suffer the fact that I made that mistake, and I've gone ahead and put my cards back in this tray, because now I don't know. I'd have to go back in the video and look to see which ones were here and which ones weren't. So I'm not going to take that back. I'm going to take that as a whoops, I just made a mistake. So this Battle Goal card, sorry guys, is not going to end up happening. I probably could have done it, but I just screwed myself. So I'm just going to turn that over like that. I did a short rest, so that's too bad. But it's okay, because the Craig Hart's actually fairly advanced, already level 3. Losing one check mark's not going to kill us. We'll be fine. But that's on me, guys. So that's a mistake I made. So now we're going to do the short rest on the Tinker, who is definitely able to do short rest, because the Tinker's battle card is to just ensure that there's enemies on the board at the end of the turn, so that's fairly straightforward. We'll take this one. Attack one, stun, and move forward. That's okay. I'm okay with losing that one. That's not a very powerful card in the first place. The ones I wanted back were definitely this one, attack 3. That's one of the stronger ones. The healing card is also very important. This attack 2 and poison is also good. And then this one's the really one I wanted, the reviving shock. I really like the reviving shock. And the reason is because it can hit two targets at once, and I think this is the time to use it. So we're going to go ahead now and actually legitimately start round 10. So we're going to pick our cards. I want to use Reviving Shock, 100%. I also want to boost my health, because I know in these waning minutes or so of this game, we're going to get into a tough situation where we're going to have enemies show up, and they're going to want to just take us out. And we're going to have so many of these guys around us, it's going to be terrible. So if I go ahead and do this attack, I could likely do an attack on him and on him. And then I just need to do something in order to boost it to make sure that it kind of, you know, does something productive. So I don't think I can necessarily kill the elite, but he does have 11 damage on him, and 14 is what I'm aiming for. So I only need 3. He's only got 1 shield. So it's doable if I get a lucky pull. So I'm going to go for it. I'm also going to use this one, which allows me to add 1 to all... to me and all adjacent allies this round. Now, it's not exactly the best one to use right now because my Craig Hart's going to... well, I short rested with the Craig Hart, so maybe it's fine. This is a good time to use it, actually, I think. So we'll do it this for now. And, of course, that benefit only comes into play if the Craig Hart goes after the Tinker, so we're going to have to make sure that we do that, although that's kind of where things get dicey. That's kind of where things get dicey. I may not get this benefit when I actually want it. 34s... it's early, but I don't know if it's going to be early enough to get any real benefit out of that. Maybe I change my mind on that one for now. And if I'm doing the top of Reviving Shock, maybe I'll focus on Mobilize. No, that's no good for me right now. Healing, move and healing. Heal affects adjacent allies. Not really what I want to do. You know what? I do want to go first, though. And I want to make sure I go first, because once these guys get on us and start attacking us, we're going to take a lot of damage. So I'm going to try to push ourselves to go first, at least with the Tinkerer. So 17 will be the top initiative card here. And we got a heal in case we need it. For the Craighart, the main focus is going to be a backup attack. We need something that can do some damage. We need something that can hit and do some hurt, some pain on them. At least based on what I've got with the Tinker, no elements are going to be infused, so I won't be able to take any benefits from that. Healing might not be a bad idea. We can also... I could also boost my range attacks, which may be a good idea. Depending on the... like, just this might be actually really smart to do right now. Although this is a really nice attack. I don't know if I want to use that card for that or not. We really just need something that can... we need a... you know what? This one's good. Let's do the Earthen Clod, because it's a range 5. So that's going to allow me to really hit anything I pick within a fairly long range. And these guys are going to probably get closer. Plus it has the heal there if I need it, which is always useful if I stay still. And then if I decide to do the heal... and or if I decide to do the attack and I want to do a heal or something else, the rest of all mine are, well, maybe this is when I can do this plus one to my attack just to boost it, right? So that's not terrible. I guess what is terrible is using this attack 3 right now, but or I might end up using the attack 3 if they get close to me. I don't know, this gives me options. So I'm okay with that. I'll go with that. So 38, 17 of the two cards. Sorry, but taking a little bit there to figure that out. So now we're going to go ahead and we're going to flip. Now we are in the 10th round. So 10th round is an even round. So lowest initiative is spawned. So 43 is not very low. 41 is lower though. So lurkers are winning. And the Frost Demon wins out. So it looks like we are going to have another Elite Frost Demon joining the ranks. So I'm going to go ahead and get an Elite base on him. And when the Frost Demons come out... all the movement for character and allies are reduced by 1. Now, that's not a big deal because nobody's going to be moving. I don't really plan to move, but... and the good thing is with the Frost Demons, it's far away, which is really nice. So it's going to keep them out of our area, which is great. So now what's going to happen is... what do we do next? So Frost Demons go second. It looks like the Craighart is going to... or the Tinkerer's Art is going to go first. So we're going to definitely do our attack 2, range 3... and target. Now, the Tinkerer's focus is going to be this guy and this guy. So what I'm going to do is I will do the movement 2 as well. So I'm going to do a move 2, which is essentially just going to be like me going like this. I'm going to heal an adjacent ally. So I'm going to heal my Craighart, boosting him up to get him ready for whatever comes our way later. And then I'm going to attack. The attack 2 is going to go against this elite first, who I'm targeting for the first one. And this attack 2 is going to be... again, he's got a shield on this elite, as you can see right there. So we're going to have to really hope to get a good attack in order to kill him. I don't know if that's going to happen, but we'll do our best. Ooh, so that negated the entire attack. So nothing happened there. So that's unfortunate. But then I get a choice to attack another one. And I'm going to choose to attack this guy because I just don't need him on the board anymore. And I'm worried that he's going to try to come over here and attack us. And I need to get him out of there first. And based on his card, he's going to. So let's attack him. He is a heal. He has a shield 2, so he basically already negates my attack. So really, I need to get a 1 or higher in order to get that extra 1 HP I need, because he's 5. He's a regular Wind Demon to kill him. So here's hoping. Gah! No! So that didn't pan out either. So it looks like in the end, we failed on both of the shots against the enemy. So that was terrible. So this is going to go over here. And then this one here was already used and we healed, so that's also discarded. And then we're going to go ahead and do the next character in play. Now we know the Frost Demons are next at 18. They're going to immobilize all targets within range 2, but they're so far away that nothing is going to be immobilized. And then if there is a Frost element, they're going to heal, but they have no damage and there is no Frost, so they're done. That's pretty nice. I like the fact they didn't have any movement. It means they're going to stay far away from me, giving me a better chance to survive. Okay, so then we're gonna move to the Craighart, who luckily gets to go next to potentially help. Now this is where things get interesting. So we know that the Elite can come and hit us. Now the Elite, when he comes to trying to hit us, he's able to target 2 of us. That's really bad. Now both of these Elites can target two of us. And when they come on their move, they're going to move up to three. So this guy will get to where he is, and this guy's going to be on top of us. We've got 11 damage on him already, and he's got a shield of one. Now, I think it might be more important to go after... I don't know. Either way, we're kind of in trouble. But in terms of focusing, I guess I got to decide which one's going to be... Like, this guy will be coming at the Tinker. The Tinker has the least amount of health. We don't want that. This guy would come after... He's three away. Actually, sorry, he's ranged. So he would stay put and he would shoot from here. One, two, three, and one, two, three. He's in range for both. So he would also go after the Tinker. So regardless, we just have to make sure that one of them is dead. Because we know one of them is going to get an attack on us, regardless of what we do. So the next question to say, the next question I guess we have would be, Oh, I like this though. This is an attack three, push one. You may push the target into hexes containing obstacles. In each case, destroy the obstacle and target suffers two damage. That's actually not bad. Actually, you know what? I like that. Let's do this for a move two. So we're going to put the Craigheart right here, which is going to make him go after the Craigheart instead of going after the Tinkerer. So that's a smart move. Then we're going to use this attack three against this Elite, and we're going to push him into the barrel afterwards. So the Craigheart's going to go ahead. He's going to make an attack. It's an attack three, which is a pretty heavy attack. So we already used this one for move two. So we're going to go ahead and discard this just so it's not in the way. This one here is attack three. We know this Elite has a shield of one, so he's going to be able to block at least one of them. But we know that when we push into an obstacle, we're going to be able to put two damage on him, and we can push him into the obstacle of the barrel, which will destroy it and hit him for two. So it almost helps us guarantee that we can kill him, which is really cool. So let's do an attack three here, and we are adjacent to him, but it's a regular melee attack. It's not a ranged attack, so we're good to go with a regular attack. Oh my gosh, of all the cards to pull. Okay, so... it's an attack two, minus two, right? And then we're gonna go ahead and, oh, that was the worst card we could have pulled. So it's, so it's attack three, minus two, minus one for the shield. So that ends up being a zero. He does get pushed back to here and destroys this obstacle. He destroys the barrel. When he does that, we get two damage to put on him. It says the target suffers two damage and you gain XP. Sadly, it's just one shy of actually killing it, which is insane. Blows my mind we weren't able to actually do that with such a strong card, but we do get the XP from it even though we failed to actually generate a kill there, which is too bad. Wow, we really didn't have a good round on that one so far. So now that he's the Craigheart is done and crying, because actually everything we wanted to do this round failed. We failed on the Tinker failed to kill something, the Craigheart failed to kill something, just everything went sideways. So now we're going to go ahead and go for the Lurkers, which is bad. Now the Lurkers, if the frost was available, they'd consume it to strengthen themselves. There is no frost, that is not going to happen. They're going to move because there are melee characters, they want to get close to us to attack us. They don't get any bonus for movement, but their regular movement, being elite, is both three. So this one here is going to obviously focus on the Craigheart, but we'll pick them based on the numbers on them. So we'll go ahead with this one here is three. So one, two, three. So regardless, they're all on the Craigheart, which is bad news for us. Then they're each going to take an attack, which is also bad news for us. So the Lurkers, when they attack, they target two people. But as of right now, they're melee, so there's no one else to target. Thankfully, the Tinker's hiding in the distance, so he's okay. So we're going to go ahead and... oh, you know what, actually? Now that I think about this... just hold on a second. I have a different plan. I'm going to change something here. So we had this Lurker who was here. We had this guy who was 1, 2, 3 here. And this guy was here, if I remember correctly. I'm going to go ahead and I am going to, instead of because we know the Lurkers are going to go ahead and move all over the Craigheart and attack him, the last player to go was the Craigheart. I'm actually going to use my Cloak of Invisibility because I know, because these are melee characters, they won't be able to find focus on him. So what's this going to do? Maybe that's actually bad too, though. Kind of all bad, really. No, I'll just play it out. We're not going to use the cloak. We're going to play it as we had it. I don't want to mess anything up anyway in terms of where they were sitting. So they were sitting here. They're attacking the Craghart. So we got to attack. They're both going to attack with a minus one on their four. So they're going to attack me with three, but they're going to wound me too. And wounding is not really the greatest. It says if a figure is wounded, it suffers 1 point of damage at the start of each of its turns. If a heal ability is used on it, then the wound token is removed. So that's bad. Now we don't have many rounds left anyway, so we might be okay, but still that's not good. So the attack's going to happen. It's an attack four, minus one. We'll do this guy, or we'll do the one first, the elite one. So it's going to be three coming through at me. And then we're going to go out to pull a modifier to see what happens. So two, that's okay. We'll take that damage. So we're going to drop ourselves from 11 down to nine. Then we're going to come over here and we're going to do this second one. Now we know that the wound tokens already applied because the first one already hit us. So we'll just go ahead and put the wound token. I'm going to turn these sideways so that we can actually see the Craghart. But the Craghart's going to have one wound token next to him now. And then this guy's going to go ahead and attack. Do the exact same thing. He's attacking with a three. I'm going to pull a card. Plus one. Ouch. So that's a four. So this is where we got to make a decision. Losing a card or taking damage. Losing a card might be a good idea here because we have, well, maybe not. We have six cards even, so that allows us to go three more rounds. So I'm gonna take the damage. So it's four, so two, three, four. So we're down to five on the Craghart, which is not the greatest. Okay, so that's that. That's pretty much all I want to do there. So the lurkers have both gone. They've wounded me, and they're the only ones that are attacking me, so they're done. And then we have the wind demon, who's also going to do some damage. So the wind demon is going to move minus one. So the minus one on a regular unit for wind is going to make him two. Two is enough to get him... no, again, he's ranged, so he doesn't need to get any closer to me. He's going to be targeting me because I'm the closest to him in range. So it's going to be an attack against the Craghart. So this attack is going to hit him. It's going to be a three attack, plus one, which makes it four already, which is really, really nasty. So we're going to see what happens here. Oh, wow. Okay. So five. So that's too much damage for him to take. He has to lose a card in order to negate that, because that's just way, way, way too powerful. So we're going to go ahead and pick a card from our hands that we think is not going to be useful for us. And I think the backup ammunition is probably the one that we're not likely to use as much this time. So I'm going to lose that card to negate that damage. So we're okay for now. And then that's the end of this turn. Now we still have Drell here, who's going to make an attack on Barty. And Drell's going to be attacking for three. And it's going to be going after Barty, and ended up getting awesome. We got a null. So that means we don't have to lose a card. So essentially Drill's attack on Barty was a complete fail. So that's great news. Now we have one less, because otherwise it's likely that damage would have forced us to have to lose a card, because they're both, like, Barty's not looking so hot right now. Almost guaranteed would have. So we avoided something bad. Even though we couldn't kill half the enemies that were on this board here, we still are okay. And the cool thing is, everything's weighing down already. We have cards to play the next round, so I'm not going to short rest. I'm not short resting with a tinker. We are going to shuffle cards that need to be shuffled, but there is nothing here except for just this deck. So off camera, I'm going to do this shuffle here. And then we're going to be moving into the next video. We'll be moving into round 11, guys. So we've got a chance here to pull this off. I really, really think we can do this. We've got a really, really strong hand over here and a really strong hand over here. We have cards to lose. I think we're going to survive this. So anyway, hope you guys are enjoying. Unless, of course, we get totally surrounded by these guys later, it's going to be bad. But as of right now, we're doing all right. So hope you guys like what you're seeing. Hit the like button if you do. And come join me on the next round as we move into round 11 and see if we can survive. Until next time, keep rolling solo.